Right, so I think we can go.
Good?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, thanks everybody for coming. You guys are the true diehards of the summit here, coming on Thursday afternoon. I'm Jeff Applewhite. I'm a technical marketing engineer at NetApp, and we have Arthur Berezin from Red Hat.
Yes, so I'm Arthur Berezin, a senior technical product manager with Red Hat. And today we're going to present you our joint solution with NetApp and Red Hat. So.
Yeah. So this is our agenda. We're going to talk, talk a little bit about the OpenStack Platform 6 and talk about NetApp's integrations with OpenStack a bit, and then go into some details on actually deploying Red Hat OpenStack with the NetApp integrations for Cinder. And I'll show you some, screenshots and a little bit of demo on how you can actually get that done. So I'll turn it over to Arthur for some Red Hat OpenStack 6.
Thank you. Yeah. So Red Hat Enterprise Linux OpenStack Platform 6. You all know what OpenStack is. You've been throughout this week listening on the various components, going over them, and studying each and every one of them. So in a single word, OpenStack is basically a platform or a framework to build various cloud-based solutions. So why would you choose Red Hat as a distribution for running OpenStack in your environment? So as you all have seen, OpenStack is a framework to run various infrastructure as a service components. You can run storage as a service, you can run computing as a service, etc. Now, all of these components are basically Linux services that run on the base operating system. Now, the important part there is that they're basically each and every one of those components are using existing components and subsystems of the bare operating system it runs on. So basically, OpenStack, it's really hard to decouple the OpenStack components from the base operating system, since they're all based on technologies that exist within the base operating system itself. So part of what we do is basically is co-engineer the various components of OpenStack with existing Linux kernel and various subsystems of the bare OS itself. So, and this is really important because the integration is really tied between the various components. So you have the hardware, the bare metal that runs the actual operating system, and then on top of the operating system you have OpenStack running. Now OpenStack uses those components, for example KVM. It uses the network stack, for example, to implement various parts of Neutron. It uses namespaces and SELinux, for example, to implement security components of OpenStack. Now, this is a whole integrated solution that basically uses one, each component uses another component to implement the various as-a-service components as part of the distribution that you use. So this is one part. The other part is basically the partner ecosystem around that. Obviously, OpenStack comes always with various plugins and drivers that you use. You never use OpenStack vanilla by itself. You always use some sort of drivers or some sort of extensions to actually integrate the environment with your real-world application and real-world existing environments that you already run. So we run a really extensive partner ecosystem through which we certify various vendors to use the various drivers and to run on top of OpenStack. And part of that is also testing and covering and making sure that solutions are fully functional and working as they should work. And also we work with the vendors to solve problems if they come along once a customer encounters such issues. So part of the distribution, we also have an installer that makes the whole deployment of OpenStack much easier. And this is really key to deploy OpenStack quickly to an environment. So the installer is basically an intuitive wizard-based deployment tool for OpenStack Platform 6 called OpenStack RelOSP Installer. And this is based on the Foreman plus Puppet modules and the web UI wizard that helps you navigate through the deployment process of an environment. And part of that installer, it also deploys in a highly available configuration, which I'll go over a bit later. So this installer also supports various plugins and extensions. So it obviously supports the NetApp ONTAP devices, which Jeff will cover later on. And this really helps and makes it much easier to deploy a production environment in such configurations. So Red Hat has joined the OpenStack community for almost the very beginning of OpenStack in July 2011, and we've been a top contributor since the Grizzly release. So we're very active in the community, as you've all seen throughout the sessions today. And if you had a chance to glimpse at the design sessions, so you've also seen the participants of Red Hat within the various components. Now, we've been a top contributor since Grizzly release, but I think the important piece here is basically that Red Hat is contributing not for a specific particular component. Basically, we're working across the board to make sure all of the components are working, contributing to all of the components relatively equally without, you know, choosing specific components. Now, this actually helps us support our customers. Since we have a relatively good influence over the community, and we have a really, really good overview of what our customers are doing in their real-world production environments, so this really helps us influence the way the community is implementing the various components and the various features across the components. And this also helps us drive new features within those components, since we have a relatively good influence and contribution across the board, across the various components themselves. So Red Hat is open source an open source company, and this is basically part of our DNA, right? So we always contribute to the community first. And basically from those communities, we pick and choose and create our own community version distribution of those communities. So for example, we have the OpenStack community. And from that, we basically build the RDO distribution, which is really close to the upstream bits that you'll see, and basically an RPM-based version distribution for the upstream OpenStack release. And from that upstream distribution, we produce a enterprise-grade distribution, which is called Red Hat Enterprise Linux OpenStack Platform. So the difference between the RDO and the community's basic and the community version is that the RDO is an RPM-based version, and it runs on the major enterprise-grade operating systems. Obviously, it runs on RHEL. It also runs on CentOS and on Fedora and all on RPM-based operating systems. It follows really closely to the upstream life cycle. So if we have a release every 6 months, every major release for OpenStack, every 6 months, we will have probably about a week or a couple of weeks later an RDO-based version. And following that, we have about a period of about 2 to 3 months where we stabilize the release, basically do a lot of bug fixes that we contribute to the community later on. And 2 to 3 months later, we release an enterprise-grade stable release, Red Hat Enterprise Linux OpenStack Platform. And that has a 3 years life cycle. So basically, you know you will get your support throughout that time and get bug fixes and security fixes, etc. Yeah. So by the end of the day, why would you choose Red Hat Enterprise Linux OpenStack Platform? So basically, you have an enterprise-grade hardened version. This is a version that is stable, that has been tested by our quality assurance engineers, and we've been solving a lot of fixes that we see coming in each upstream release. Basically, we contribute those fixes back, but we have them in the enterprise version. So we also, again, as I mentioned before, we also integrate the various components. This is something we take very seriously to make sure that delivered talks to KVM, and the usage of delivered in KVM with Nova Compute, for example, is working properly, and we do it across the board for various components. Now we also, as I mentioned, we have a 3-year production phase. Cycle, so we know the version is supported for 3 years, and you know, you also leverage from the large ecosystem where we have, for example, with NetApp today, that Jeff will talk about in a bit. So, yeah, I think I'm gonna skip the HA part. Jeff.
Thanks, Arthur. So I'm going to talk a little bit now about NetApp's integrations, our history with OpenStack, just to give you a little bit of context for the work that's been going on. So NetApp has a pretty long involvement with the OpenStack project, going back to, you know, basically the Essex release, where we released our first driver. Actually, Rob Esker's sitting in the back, who's had involvement in this effort for quite a long time. We were, you know, a charter member, a gold member of the foundation, you know, summit sponsors. We were the first major storage provider in the community, really, in the center project, you know, with upstream contributions and numerous production deployments. In fact, the recent user survey for the OpenStack Foundation found that NetApp is the number one enterprise storage deployed in OpenStack deployments today. So, and that continues to be the case and even growing. So. We're quite happy about that. We're also a deployer of OpenStack internally. We have you know, 4,000 node deployment doing you know, various workloads related to engineering or support internally running on Red Hat OpenStack, and so it's a growing thing for this for us as a company. You know, just from the sort of back out, the 10,000 foot view, you know, in my view, every release seems to be getting better. You know, the 6 month cadence is always about features, but because of the continuous integration and the automation of the testing that goes on in OpenStack, you can pretty well rely that the quality is stable, in fact, getting better. And certainly from NetApp's perspective, our quality efforts have really grown a lot. We have an internal CI. We spun up, I think, you know, we've had since April, maybe 50,000 VMs spun up for various tests. So when we submit code, before it even goes upstream, we test it internally, and it runs against all of our protocol modes. So whether, even if we're only changing something related to NFS, it gets tested against Fibre Channel and iSCSI and the other modes that we operate in. So the other thing is that HA deployments are on a rise. You know, a lot of the early testing and tweak, if you're just pulling bits down and configuring manually, you know, you're obviously not configuring HA, but the tool sets with Puppet and, you know, the Foreman installer really make HA quite easy to achieve. We'll get into that in a bit, and I'll show you the integrations that we've done. From a high level, you know, we participate, you know, primarily in two projects, but we have integrations with other projects as well. So our primary efforts are obviously in the Cinder and Manila projects, Cinder being the block storage project and Manila being file sharing. But they have integrations with the compute because, you know, obviously you're attaching VMs through Nova, or we have integrations with Glance that I'll describe in a bit in a later slide, where we can do advanced rapid cloning, basically, features using our flex clone technology. And the real benefit of that is reducing time to boot. So we also have, you know, E-Series is an option for deploying Cinder as well as Swift, and I'll talk a little bit about our E-Series platform. Many of you, if you're NetApp customers or know NetApp, you may not be as familiar with E-Series, so I'll talk a bit about that. FAS, you know, the continuous operations is really its main focus. It's, you know, it has advanced data management features. I spoke about flex clones, but, you know, everybody that knows NetApp is familiar with the, you know, ability to do basically zero performance impacting snapshots, you know, and they happen in a millisecond. So, you know, where you have workloads where you need to be able to snap, for instance, a database in hot backup mode and take that instant snapshot and go right back to operations, that's really where FAS excels. It can also do advanced mirroring, which we've exposed through Cinder. We have ways to filter through what we call extra specs. on various different capabilities that we have. So whether we want to enable dedupe on the back, deduplication, a compression, mirroring, if we want to filter on disk type, let's say you have, in a later slide I'll show you a little bit clearer, but we can filter on the underlying disk type of the aggregates as well. So that's a pretty nice feature to have. You can provide what we call the storage service catalog, so you can have a sort of listing of various services that you're offering up with, as a cloud operator. E-Series excels in performance. It basically, E-Series grew up in the world of high-performance computing, so parallel file systems, really super high throughputs, bandwidth, you know, think of really, you know, high-performance serial writes, where you have workloads that that require that kind of performance. It's a great fit for that, and I'll talk a bit more about E-Series in a minute. As I said, we have integration with Glance. The first thing is that you know, using NetApp as a Glance data store makes a lot of sense when you enable deduplication. I've personally used dedupe on data stores where I have multiple images, OS images, and gotten 90%. Actually, I got 98% deduplication in one of my test projects, but that was where all the VMs are the exact same OS. So if you have drift from that and you have differences in your operating systems, you know, let's say you have different versions of Linux or what have you, you'll still get really good deduplication. So you're basically paying for, you know, one block out of 10 because you're able to, you know, free those blocks up through the deduplication technology. The other big win with NetApp in OpenStack is with FlexClone. For, you know, in many summits you'll hear there's a big focus on operators wanting to reduce their time to boot. And one of the ways you can do that is to simply eliminate the copying that has to happen from Glance over to Sender. And the way we do that is it's just transparent. You don't have to really do anything to enable that. The first time you pull from Glance, we'll cache that image file in the Flex volume that's hosting your Sender volumes. And thereafter, second, third, and fourth, all the remaining copies to Sender from that Glance image are a Flex clone, and they take milliseconds. So literally you can reduce all the pull time from Glance and be off and booting your VM basically immediately once you've done that first copy from Glance. So that's a big win. If you're, you know, it's people don't like to wait for their VMs to come up. They want to see immediate gratification, click boot, and there you go. And so it's a good way to enable that. As I mentioned, we have what we call the storage service catalog, and this is simply illustrating that you can create through the Sender extra specs here, whether you're talking about, you know, the RAID type, the disk type, whether it's SAS, SATA disk, or, you know, flash disk, or all flash FAS, we can enable that with an extra spec. So you can create a volume type that you can filter on. So, you know, the typical, you know, gold, silver, bronze scenario, but these are very customizable. You can pick out the different attributes that we enable here. Also deduplication, mirroring, if you had, you know, high value workloads, databases that you want to mirror that data to remote location, you can create an extra spec based on that mirroring volume type. So, and just basically the scheduler will be smart and know where to put it if you select that volume type. It's also be useful if, you know, you're trying to show, you know, charge back and, you know, you basically, as an operator, you know, you can over-provision, you know, within provisioning, or you can turn on deduplication, and actually it's even well beyond thin provisioning. So now I'll shift a little bit and talk a little about our joint work. And this is actually, this slide probably needs to be updated because we are even today working with Red Hat moving forward on RHEL OSP 7 and the integrations going forward. But we work with them, you know, to expose our Sender driver as of RHEL OSP 5. And the native GUI support came out in RHEL OSP 6 in the A2 release, A2 and A3 releases. So if you want to, and I'll show you in a minute here, we'll have a screenshots of those enablements. And we have, you know, regular meetings with Red Hat. We're trying to align our product, you know, roadmap. We're working closely with them on the Manila project to enable that going forward. So there's a lot of tight alignment there. So more to come. I guess the last point there would be that, you know, obviously there's supportability. So our as Arthur mentioned, there's a certification process. So that our drivers actually get tested with the Red Hat certification suite, so that when you go to deploy, all the functionality that's expected within Sender is going to operate because we pass those certification tests. So this is a bit of an overview for the FAS. I don't want to call your attention to too much. It's kind of busy from a network standpoint, but the main thing I want to sort of draw your attention to is the two different storage networks here. There's basically a storage management network, which would be your administrative connection to make Zappy calls to the controller. And then there's going to be the actual data network where you're serving data traffic, whether it's NFS or iSCSI or what have you. And then, you know, all this is sort of enabled, obviously, through the Red Hat installer, which is, you know, discovering the nodes that are in the network. They're pixie booting. They're coming up. They're getting discovered, recognized. You'll see them in the console, and then you can, you know, perform operations on them from there. This is sort of an alternative deployment architecture here with our E-Series platform. In this case, it's a similar thing. The control path is going to happen through the web services proxy, which will proxy, you know, the RESTful calls that come into it to the E-Series array, and then the data path there again, the iSCSI traffic will happen over, you know, a data network. So just a variation on the same theme. So here we're actually looking at the start of a new OpenStack deployment in the Red Hat OpenStack installer. This is sort of assuming that you've already done your discovery, you already have nodes, you have hardware that's been discovered, it's come up, it's on the network, it's been registered with Foreman, and so then we're ready to go and do a new deployment here. I'm obviously don't have time to cover every single part of this, but I'm kind of giving you the highlights here. There's some choices here as far as high availability, which obviously you want to enable. There's, you know, choices related to the networking subsystem, whether you want to do Neutron or Nova, whether you want RabbitMQ or Cupid, and, you know, generating unique passwords, et cetera. And then next, in this case, you're going to actually be, the networks are going to be, they'll show up here. This is sort of post dragging them down. You can drag your, you predefine your networks, but then you drag them down to the proper location. And so this gives you a lot of flexibility as far as your network design, depending on what your needs are. And then this is a service, I'm skipping a little bit here, but this is sort of the two critical things in the NetApp deployment. You'll see there's an NFS option. We recommend that you deploy to NFS, as I spoke about the deduplication and the way to do flex clones from the NFS data store. In this case, you know, the NFS server is living at Vol Glance, and then moving along to the sender configuration, if you see there's a NetApp checkbox, and you'll see that it's enabling those three protocol or those three modes, cluster data on tap, you know, 7 mode, and the E-Series platform. And the, you know, the fields obviously auto update depending on the selection there. This is sort of a detail view of just cluster data on tap mode with NFS. You remember I spoke about the control path versus the data path. Hostname here is the administrative interface for your FAS. So that's where you'd actually go to SSH in or run, you know, Zappy calls against your FAS appliance. Obviously needs credentials to get in. We recommend secure, you know, protocols, HTTPS. And then you give it a, you know, NFS shares path. So in this case, the sender volumes will go to Vol Sender. And you give it a shares. This is a file that actually is going to, this data is going to get stuffed into the NFS shares config file. And the last option here is actually pointing it to the particular storage virtual machine that's on the controller. So for those of you that aren't familiar with what an SVM is, NetApps can, you know, obviously they can be clustered from 2 nodes up to 24 nodes, and you can have multiple storage virtual machines that are kind of a chunk of storage and network space that can be dynamically moved around between those 24 nodes for, you know, non-disruptive upgrades. If you need to do upgrades on one node, you move off services to another node, and you can operate and then fail back. And so there's a lot of advanced features that are enabled through that. So we recommend that you deploy through the SVM. Actually, require it for CMU. And this screen shows some of the nodes that are available to do the deployment to. So you can see here that I've selected all nodes. This works great if you have identical hardware. If you don't, you need to get very specific with each individual piece of hardware, because when we get to the next step, we're going to be actually selecting how are we going to bond our network interfaces. So as I mentioned, you know, you set up your network ports are going to be enabled through LACP, you know, so you can do failover between the bonded interfaces. And I'll show you in the next step here. We'll configure networks there. And so basically, you can set your bonding mode. In this case, in our deployment guide, we recommend LACP, which is that 802.3AD mode. And you pull your, you know, to the bonded you select the interfaces here. You can see there's two physical interfaces in our bond. There could be two or more. You can drag your particular VLANs to that bonded pair, and you basically are set up to do, you know, high availability failover there. As far as things that I learned in the process and working with Red Hat, it's very important, obviously, to sort of measure twice and deploy once, or cut once, as the carpenters used to say. Kind of make sure your environment is set up right to begin with. Double check your networking, your switch ports, all that stuff needs to be set up right for the deployment to be successful. So there's a lot of planning. You really need to think through, you know, the deployment. You can't just sort of go and willy-nilly click next finish. It's not that simple. There's a lot of, you know, sort of planning and documenting before you go through it. As far as the installer itself, you need to make sure that basically you want your installer to be capable to be kind of a NAT router to the internet or to your source for your YUM repository. So that's basically the test. You want to make sure that your IP tables rules are correct for that. Let's see, if you're doing testing, and you know, I recommend that you do start very simple, maybe even with a single controller node. Just do that as a deploy a single controller, see what it brings up, see how the services interoperate with each other. And if you want to change things, you need to change the immutable flag. For example, you want to play around with your sender conf and you want to enable two different backends or something like that. What's going to happen is next time Puppet runs, it's going to clobber your sender conf file and revert everything you've changed. So you're going to have to prevent that with this command here if you want to do some testing outside of, because Puppet basically takes control of the nodes once you've done the installation. For those of you that are familiar with Puppet. Also, you know, as I said, start simple. Test with a single controller. Make sure that works great. You can delete the deployments. It's no problem. You can, you know, reboot your hosts. Once they've been deleted in the console, you reboot them. They get rediscovered again if they're set to boot to the network. Pixie will discover them. You can redo your deployment. So it's very easy to kind of iterate through you know, simple and then get a little more complex. And so you can build up a deployment that's successful. You got to be patient because there's a lot going on with this installer. It's performing a lot of tasks as it's moving through. I mean, you'll see, you know, early on, you'll see, you know, the basic services coming out, the database services, the chorusing and pacemaker, and you'll see Glance come up, and then, you know, finally you'll see Sender come up, and, you know, Nova and those services. So it just takes a while. You can, if you get impatient, you can hop on a node console and run top and see what's going on, you know, see the services coming up, but Puppet's doing a lot of things in the background. If you have an issue, if something doesn't match up, if you have a network port that's not matching properly or services can't talk, one thing you can do is hop on the failed node. If you have, for instance, you have a controller that fails, you can just hop on the console, run Puppet agent-t and with the debug, and it'll actually run and you can see the output of it and help you debug, you know, some of the problems that you might be encountering. So these are a couple of docs that I'm referring you to. The first one is our HA deployment guide. Bob Calloway wrote that. He's sitting in the back there. And the second one is the deployment guide that I wrote based on the platform 5. The screenshots that you saw are basically just slight updates from that process. Some of the things that were complicated in RHEL OSP 5 for us are now quite simple with the GUI integration. So some of the stuff in this doc here would apply, and some will just be irrelevant because the GUI basically takes care of setting up Sender for you now. So any questions? Yeah, sure.
Can we use iSCSI or Fiber for the Sender backend instead of NFS?
So if you're using FAS, you can use iSCSI or NFS, and whether that's 7 mode or C mode, whichever type of controller you have, or clustered on tap or 7 mode, I should have said. And if you're using the E series, it's iSCSI. Yep.
Can you add fiber channel if let's say in the future you wanted to deploy RHEL OS P7?
I think that's in the pipe.
Okay.
Yeah, Fiber Channel's on the way. Actually, Fiber Channel's enabled, right?
Yeah. So the installer for OSP7 would not be based on Foreman, it would be based on the Triple O and Tasker work. So when, but that would probably come in a pipe later on.
Yeah. All anything right. else? Thanks, you guys are troopers for being here late on a Thursday afternoon. So, thank you.
Thank you, guys.
All right.